Wisconsin, you're listening to Raised in Wisco with like the worst ever music in the world.
What in the
Danielle,
world?
Did you pick this?
I did pick all four of these. I'm sorry, what ones did you pick?
Led Zeppelin? I mean, that's like, they do a concert, you might as well hand out razor blades when people go
in. Oh, lordy.
So depressing. Oh, my gosh.
You're depressing. Come on.
I am not depressing.
That was very depressing to say.
Well, Led Zeppelin. Okay, I'm not going to say they're not talented. I just can't stand them.
I think I may have two intro songs from them.
From Led Zeppelin?
Yeah.
Oh, boy.
I hope next
Anastasia's
time when you're
yawning
gone.
Already.
No. I'm cracking up because we just got our first text of the show, you guys. And said no.
No.
I don't know what that means.
That means they don't want it either.
Oh, no, maybe it's no to you.
No, I think that means no Led Zeppelin, please.
Okay,
oh, my gosh.
Let's throw this out there right now.
I was having a good day, too. Now I'm all depressed.
Suffer, you're like, still smiling ear to ear. Calm
I'm
down.
Buying a stair.
Give us a call at 844-967-2789 to tell us that Joel is wrong and I am right.
Okay.
Or give us
really
or give us or give us new intro song. Who knows?
Hey. Can I just tell you that this is the most maddening time of the year for me? You would think it would be complete and total excitement all the time because right now we're in Wisconsin, the greatest state in the country, in the greatest nation in the world, right? Duck is open now.
Oh, sure is.
Goose is open now.
Oh yeah.
Whitetail's open, turkey's open. Morning dove is open. What am I missing? Coyote.
Squirrel.
Small game's open. Crow's open.
All the things.
Everything is open. So now it literally goes, you go from the end of August. Go ahead.
And cold fronts come on. Cold front's right around the corner. So it is here. It is fall. We are ready to go. Let's rumble.
Yes.
Let's shoot.
You need to get out hunting more, I think. I think you need to get out hunting
more. I'm sorry, 12-hour days.
I know.
6 days a week. Okay, well, 8 hours on Saturday. But yes, I do.
Well, I hope you're making some ching to buy some absolutely. Do we have a caller in there, Anastasia? Who do we got?
We got somebody to tell me that I am right and you're wrong.
Well, what a surprise. They're going to side with you. Anytime you get someone else in the studio, you team up on me. I'm totally used to that by now.
And it is a full studio.
All right, who do we
today?
Got? What's their name? Mouth it to me because our computer's
It's someone
down.
You should know. It is one of the Kennedy clan members.
Oh, my gosh. The Kennedy clan.
I'm so excited.
Robin, what's
up?
I always know when Robin doesn't want to talk to me on the phone because she answers it like, hey, Joel, what's up? So our five loyal listeners in Oconomowoc, the Kennedy clan, who we have turned into outdoors people who eat nothing but wild game now in their family. They buy nothing from the store. They eat only wild game. Robin Kennedy. Robin, what's up?
Okay, Danielle asked, I had to call in and say Led Zeppelin is awesome.
Well,
thank
of course you,
you
like Led Zeppelin. Okay, Robin's total leftover hippie. What do you expect?
And Robin,
I mean, what a surprise.
I'm wearing patchouli too.
Oh my gosh, Robin wears patchouli. It is absolutely the worst. There's nothing worse. When I smell patchouli, I feel like I've eaten dirt the previous 3 days. It is the worst smell I've ever had in my life. You guys are probably like the Doors too, and the Beatles.
I get compliments all the time.
No, you don't get compliments on patchouli.
I was in Quick Trip, and some dude was standing in front of me. He turned around. He's like, "Are you wearing patchouli?" I'm like, "Oh." It's not the breakfast sandwich.
That's icky on all fronts. Are you wearing patchouli? What, are you guys going to go off to Burning Man together? I mean, gosh. Forget about it. Patchouli.
Oh, Robin, I love you.
All right. Well, thanks a lot, Robin. Thanks for listening. Five loyal listeners. The Kennedy, that's our. You know she's like my boss, right?
You know, she's like one of my greatest friends.
Yeah, she's fantastic.
She's amazing.
And the work that Robin does for the disabled community is unrivaled. Her heart and soul is in it. And I want to mention that I'm really excited because next week, Marty, our first ever guest who literally bid on coming on the show, like won an auction to come on the show.
People pay for
really
this? Anastasia, why are you
this
laughing?
This is a highly desired content, Anastasia.
It's all Led Zeppelin. Let's
this
go.
This is highly desired content. Marty's coming on the show, and because of what Marty did, people with disabilities in the state of Wisconsin are going to be better off. Mm-hmm. And, of course, that's something that is very important to us. And, you know, we talk about the Outdoor Adventure Series from the A-Team, getting folks with disabilities into the outdoors, enjoying the great resources of the state of Wisconsin. So we're really excited. You'll have to listen next week. Yes. Marty's coming on the show. Going to talk about some great things.
Ooh, maybe Robin can come, too.
Maybe. No, I don't need you guys filling me with depressing music the whole time. No, thanks. Like, what's next? Like, you're going to start playing, like,
the ukulele?
Megadeth or Cannibal Corpse? Is that coming next?
I don't know what that is.
I bet Kretschmer likes Cannibal Corpse.
I have no idea.
Guys, we have a studio that is jack-packed right now with, like,
including
bros,
your mom
and my mom. My mom's becoming like a regular.
Hi, mom.
She doesn't even come in the studio. Do you want to go on the radio, mom? She says she just motioned no.
No.
Why? It's not like every other aspect of my life. You're perfectly suited to tell me about. Now you don't want to come on the radio. I'm going to tell you something. When you are the son of an Italian mother, and when you're the son of an Italian mother, your entire life, it does not matter what age you are, they will still tell you what is right, wrong, and indifferent, and they will tell you how you're supposed to do things and what they think should be portraying yourself. Like, I still can't screw up in my life because I'm afraid, like, my mom will be on my stuff.
She will be.
I didn't use one of the seven words, Anastasia. But she is a living saint, and everything that I do as far as cooking in the outdoors is owed to my mother, and I swear I absorbed it through osmosis just watching her do it through my life.
Your mom's pretty spectacular.
She is one awesome lady. I could do without, like now I'm like 52, and I think she thinks, like, when she's not around, I'm like an amoeba, like shuddering in the corner on the ground, like drooling.
What am I supposed to do?
I said, Mom, I function when you're not here. It's okay. She's like, stop. I can see her mouthing out there. Stop it. I do not do that. I love you, Mom. Thank you for coming to listen to the show from the lobby. That's probably why she doesn't want to get in here on the hot seat. But I'm telling you, it is absolutely insane, Danielle, in Wisconsin. The weather's been so warm.
Yeah,
and
it's disgusting.
It's been too warm because us hunters, we like a little cooler weather.
Mm-hmm. But standing out there in the waders, just sweating.
Yeah.
It's horrible.
I have not really, I mean, I shot a duck yesterday, a wood duck, finally. I shot a duck, but I haven't really had a lot of success. But I'll tell you, the goose hunting's been insane. Ian Kittrell from Ian, he's in my phone as Ian Wisco Waterfowl, because the first time I ever met him, Ian had Wisco Waterfowl on Instagram. And so that's like, I didn't know his last name at the time, so I just put him in as Ian Wisco Waterfowl, and it's still in there. Ian, you and I have been, like, absolutely smashing the birds this year.
It's been a great year. Lots of birds, lots of laughs, lots of memories.
I mean, Ian and I have kind of come around a little bit to kind of smaller group hunting, like not 10, 15 people in the field. And I really like that much better.
Yes, it is so much better. It's more personal. It's a lot more fun. It's not really competitive as to when you have so many people. Because I just feel like I don't want to sit up and shoot. Like, everyone else is going to shoot.
So I'm going to, I completely agree with you. I'm going to give a shout out right next to the Fishbowl, downtown Waukesha, 217 Wisconsin Avenue. Swing by, say hey. I'm told that the great John Woody Whitmore is going to call in the show today. A legend,
Woody?
A legend in his own mind.
Everybody knows in his own mind.
Go ahead. Yeah. Okay. So I am told he's calling in. Whether he follows through on that is yet to be seen.
Oh, we could always call him.
Well, you know, we probably could call him. No, Anastasia's like, no, we can't. I don't know what you're talking about.
I mean, we could call him on our phone and just, you know.
John Whitmore, he has looked like he's 65 from the time he was 15 years old. Now, the good news is
he hasn't aged
since then. So he still looks like he's 65, and now he's like 46. So
he is a heck of a shot.
Oh, my gosh. I give him the baloney. But John Whitmore, I'm not joking. This guy's got 2 1-gallon bags full of bird bands. Jeez. This guy is an absolutely prolific hunter with luck like I've never seen, and not even probably the best shotgunner, wing shooter I have ever seen in my life.
What gun does he use?
He shoots a variety of guns. Everything from Browning's to Benelli's.
I am now in the market for a new gun, so.
Well, I can talk to you about that. I've got my own personal opinions.
My Browning Maxis is.
It's done dancing.
It's pissing me off.
Ian's got something to say about this.
I just want to throw my gun
jump
at the
in.
Bird.
Real quick, yeah, before Ian talks, I just want to tell you, Ian's girlfriend, Paige.
Hi, Paige.
Hi, Paige. You can wave. Paige doesn't want to talk on the radio, so she can wave. She is in studio with us. Ian and Paige and I just ate at Eric's Porterhouse, and that food over
You
there
is, love that place.
Oh, I love that place. It's got like the supper club. My mom and dad used to take me there when I was a little kid, but
what?
It was called the Legion, wasn't it, Mom? Right next door? The Legion. It's Eric's Porterhouse now. What was it called? She doesn't remember. Yeah, it was the Legion. But we just had dinner there. Ian, so now I would like to turn this show into maybe like an advice column or a relationship show. How's it going with Paige? You guys have been dating for a while?
I am on the hot seat now. I was expecting to come here and talk about goose hunting, maybe some fishing.
You should know better than that, Ian.
I mean, I like my puns, so let's reel it back a little.
Oh, dear Lord.
That's pretty good. Kretschmer's even laughing, and he's tough to get to laugh sometimes. It was lovely meeting Paige the other day. We had a fantastic dinner, so thank you guys for dropping in.
Thank you.
I hope you hang out a little bit.
Yeah, thanks for the invite.
Okay. Wait 1 second here. What happened the last time I invited you to go to Eric's Porterhouse
last
with us?
Last time I was broke and I had
you
no money.
You bailed at the last second.
Because I had no money. I'm still an apprentice, man. But now I've been working 12-hour days.
And now you're flush with Ching, so you could come. Yeah, that's right.
Uh-oh.
Ian, I thought that we would really have kind of a slow go with the birds, but with the heat, but it hasn't stopped. They've been crazy.
And it's only getting better.
It's only getting better, and so is the show, because we've got
Led Zeppelin's
Colt
on.
Christofferson with his mega deer and bear and the legendary Mike Kretschmer. When we come back on Raised in Wisco. Jungle by
I chose this song.
What's up, folks? You're listening to Raised in Wisco. I'm your host, Joel Clapish, sitting across from the
Continue, please.
I was gonna say the not great music picking until you picked
Guns N' Roses. I'll just wait to my third choice.
You cannot go wrong with Guns N' Roses ever because they rule the universe.
Oh, do they?
Well, they are. For sure, one of the greatest things to come out of the 80s. There's no doubt about that.
I'm
getting
talk.
Nods across the studio. listen, if you, one of the first people I ever hunted with in my life was John Whitmore, who may or may not call in because he's a flake sometimes. So he may not call in. I don't know if he's going to. Or he's busy. Hey,
yeah,
let's
sure.
not
we'll
make
go,
excuses
we'll go with that one.
For him, Kretschmer. Well, Kretschmer clearly wants to talk, and I want him to talk because one of the first people who ever took me hunting in my life was Mike Kretschmer. Now, Kretschmer does not look as old as he is. You still look young. You got that baby face.
The baby
you
face.
You have become old. Ooh, yeah, don't take your hat off.
Yeah, right.
Holy crap.
Aww.
Hey, Anastasia, turn down the lights in here. Kretschmer just took his hat off. My Lord.
That's how you never see me without a hat on. People are like... You know what's funny is the other day at work, I like took my hat off. I was hot, and I like waved it back, and the girls are like, "You just hat fished me." I'm like, "What are you talking about?"
That happens all the time.
Catfish?
Oh, yeah.
You've heard that word before?
Oh, I've used that word before.
Like someone's like really handsome and then they take their hat off and you're like, what the heck? They're bald.
Yeah, we're thinking
their heads shaped really weird.
We all started laughing so hard.
Oh my gosh, that is awesome. Smokes.
Oh, yeah. We think they're all Fabio and everything and all of a sudden. Well, they're not. Yeah. They're Mr. Clean.
I don't know. I don't know what you've done, but you don't have a wrinkle on your face yet, and you're almost as old as me now. You're catching up to me, I think.
I didn't know they. You know, dirt's pretty old, Joel.
Wow. You know what? I'm glad your wife. I'm going to spare you because your wife's not here. But if your wife was here, then I would dig in. So one of the first people. You were literally one of the first people to ever take me hunting.
Yeah.
But I feel like you were way into bird hunting more when you were younger.
Yeah.
What happened?
It's called whitetails, number one, and children, whitetails. Little kids.
I tell people, Ian and I were talking about this in the field the other day. I feel like what happens to people, not everybody, there are two progressions in hunting. One is the progression from just wanting to get the harvest at the beginning, just wanting to kill something.
Yep.
Because that is extremely satisfying. Then you make something to eat out of it and you don't care how it tastes. You just want to eat it and you feel very accomplished from doing that. I mean, Danielle, would you'd agree with that, wouldn't you?
I feel like the first stage is the trophy. You want to get the trophy, you want to get the bands, and then you progress to the appreciation mode more.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, yeah. Because
when I first started, I'm like, yes, I got to get a band. I have to get piles. But now I'm just like, well, I can't get piles, so I'm just going to go for it.
It's like a mountain, right? You just want to do it. You want to get out there, and then you want to get to the next level. And then people are like, what are these mineral things? They're like, I show up next to Ian, and Ian's got a lanyard full of...
he has almost as many as me, thank you.
And, well, good. I mean, but then there's me who's been doing it
for... And he's like 10.
Literally, since I've been 12 or 13 with my dad, I'm 40 now, and I literally have probably four. Three, four. And it's just like, then the next guy goes out his first day and they blast four of them. I'm like, you got to be kidding me. It's just, that's what happens. But now, you know, like you said, the small groups, I was used to that big group number. I'd rather go two, three guys call me and go, hey, 100%. Let's go. And even if you don't kill your six or eight or whatever, but it's just.
You leave with a sore stomach because you've been laughing so hard.
Right.
That is the untold story about the amazingness of waterfowl. And I was going to say, the second iteration of hunting is, so you go from wanting to kill everything at first and then you start appreciating it and you appreciate the time out there as much as the hunt and as much, if not more than the kill.
Mm-hmm.
And then the second iteration that some people go is they move into more of the silent hunting sports, move into the whitetail hunting, move into taking a kayak by themselves to get out there. You know, they can go take that sideways banana. You'll never get me in one, but they'll go on that and try to hunt.
See, I'm definitely at that stage.
I think you are at that stage, Danielle.
Because this whole entire season, minus two hunts or one hunt with Bill, but otherwise it's just been me and Bandit the whole entire time. Like, I'm in the stage of just, I don't want to be around anybody. Just go away.
There's something to be said for that. You know, I'm getting up early every day with kids and work and everything else. And then Saturday rolls around. If the weather's not great, I'm so jacked up for this weekend.
Yeah.
One, because the cold front.
Yep.
Two, it's the youth hunt.
Yes.
Which we should talk about a little bit. But my 15-year-old, this is last year.
Hey, let's not ruin the show with substance, Mike, okay?
Yeah. I mean, right. I tried to get him to come with me and talk about it a little bit, but he's like, no. And I was like, one of these days. But my Finley, remember when we talked about turkeys the last time?
Mm-hmm.
She showed a lot of interest. I'm like, you could come on and tell your story. Yes. She's like, can I?
You should have.
We'll have to bring her with one time.
We love new hunters.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But I think you're hitting on what some of the development, the evolution of a hunter is.
100%.
Yep.
And the evolution, and Ian and I, we've evolved as hunters, but we still have that drive and that passion for birds.
Right.
I love whitetail hunting. When people say, oh, you don't even whitetail hunt. Yeah. I can't tell you how many times if I don't have a busy field, I'll sit 2 hours in the morning and hunt deer. I'll sit 2 hours in the evening and hunt deer.
But we have learned through the show that from 11 to like 3 is prime time for deer.
Yes. Yeah.
Like everyone keeps saying that. Now I'm just like, I don't have to wake up now.
Now you can start sitting out there.
This weekend will be good for it.
So I think what happens is, and you know, we see it a lot in the waterfowl industry we see people disappear from waterfowl and become whitetail hunters. Mm-hmm. But then those who stay in waterfowl end up being the more hardcore waterfowlers, right, like Ian and me, and we're the and John Whitmore, frankly.
Right.
And God dang it, we're up against a break already.
I don't know how this happens. Every single time.
Take us to the break, Danielle.
Oh, you're listening to Raised in Wisco. Give us a call at 844-967-2789. Did I stump you?
Not Tracy Chapman.
No. Oh, is it? No.
Oh, it's a country singer.
Yeah.
It's
Luke Combs, Fast Car.
Okay. Yeah, that makes sense.
Something. I need to throw a country song in there.
Yeah. Country songs. Welcome back, everybody. You're listening to Raised in Wisco on 540 AM, WAUK 101 FM, The Shaw. Rebroadcast on Saturdays as part of the Cheese Wedge.
Woo!
That's right. Raised in Wisco kicks off the Cheese Wedge, and then Charlie Barron's on the Cripecast.
Oh, Joel, do you mean the Sharp Cheddar Weekends?
The Sharp Cheddar Weekends. They changed the name of it, evidently. Wasn't it the Cheese Wedge?
No. It's always been Sharp Cheddar Weekends, my
friend. Sharp Cheddar Weekends?
I was just rolling with it.
Okay.
Too much cheese.
I mean the Sharp Cheddar Weekends.
Woo!
Featuring Raised in Wisco, followed by the Cripes Cast with Charlie Barron's, who's almost as funny as this show.
Almost?
Almost. And then Gilbert Brown, Gilbert Brown's show Under the Helmet, which is awesome. Mm-hmm. Do you remember that? Are you, Danielle, are you too young to remember the Gilbert Burger at Burger King?
Yes, because I don't.
Do you remember
eat
it,
Burger
Kretschmer?
King?
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Ian, Paige, you don't remember the Gilbert Burger, do you?
What was this? I had the cheese curd burger.
I was just
going
to say about the Culver's cheese curd burgers.
That was
back out.
Delicious.
Yeah.
I don't know if I could tackle that thing, though.
Oh, I
think it was good.
Did
I had
you make
it last
the pun
night.
On purpose?
No.
That was like an Ian.
Yeah, I don't know if I could
good
tackle. Good
just
cat.
Say yes. Good
I don't
catch.
Know if I could tackle.
Out of Ian's playbook?
Yeah. I don't know if I could tackle the Gilbert Burger. What was the Gilbert Burger?
It was just monstrous.
Like monstrous?
Triple patty back then. Now it's like common to have a triple patty burger.
Yeah, I think that is part of the reason. It's not my fault I'm fat. It's society.
Yeah.
Ian, stop laughing. Ian really Ian laughed harder at that than anything else. I'm glad I'm so good at self-deprecation. I don't mind.
What?
But Kretschmer, you were one of the people who first got me into hunting. Was my style, was I different then compared to now? I mean, what was your perception at the time?
Wait, please hold. The Gilbert Burger, the triple whopper with extra everything. Cut in half with extra cheese, no pickles. Well, you lost me at no pickles.
Yeah.
You need extra pickles.
Gotta have pickles.
I think I would have the Gilbert Burger with extra pickles.
Yeah, I
absolutely
concur.
I had a big burger tonight for dinner. My kid wanted two. I was like, dude, these are half-pound burgers. You're not eating two of these.
Did you make them?
Yeah.
Were they venison burgers?
No.
No, they were Actually, the beef company you work
yes.
for, yes?
Yep.
You're
nice.
Spending your time.
Nice. Yeah, nice.
Not the tool place.
No. So is the motto, this meat is
you
nice.
You should sell your burgers at Nice.
Yes. The tool place.
Yes. You should go out in front of Nice.
Well, yes. They have grills there.
Yeah.
Yeah.
This doesn't totally not make
could
sense.
Use like Milwaukee tool to like grind it all up, right? Yeah. Figure that
can,
out.
You can
like
figure that
done.
Out.
Done.
I'll bet you there's
let's
a TikTok
it.
Somewhere where
yeah.
they're using a heavy duty
right.
tool to
and
grind
it. And a paint
it.
Mixer or something.
I guarantee
in the
you. I think a paint mixer would work great.
Right. Absolutely would.
You could make a giant, you could make the world's largest meatloaf.
You could at least make brats.
Yeah, the yeah. meatloaf.
You could make brats.
Yeah.
Cold Christofferson is here.
Hello.
Cold, let's talk to you for a minute because I'm a little, I have to be honest, I'm a little jealous. In the last month when we've been out here busting our humps to kill geese and now ducks and turkeys and deer, you shot like a 170-inch deer, didn't you?
You've been crushing it.
Yeah, I don't have a official score yet, but 170 to 180 is where he's going to land.
Yeah, that Oof. Thing's monstrous.
And during break, he was telling me about how he made venison backstraps on the cast iron with butter and garlic and pepper, and then he made a red wine reduction sauce with beef stocks.
A 10.
I'm all about the reductions.
Yeah.
Do you know the difference between a reduction and a sauce?
The spelling?
Oh, Danielle.
Educate us.
That's that's why Danielle's here. I appreciate that. Anastasia's just kind of like shaking her head in there. Well, technically speaking, a sauce has a roux as a base, as a flour and butter, or flour and oil, and a reduction is just simmering it until it thickens, right?
Get rid of the water.
That's right. I'm a huge reduction fan.
Oh, I think you're a roux fan.
The sauce
makes
it.
Well, I love roux, too.
Like you're a roux.
I'm both.
I shall call you roux.
Why? Because of my, marsupial pouch?
You said it, Joel. No.
I can't help it. That was very quick-witted, wasn't it?
It was. You were ready for that
oh,
one.
Oh, my gosh. Because wasn't Rue a character on something at one point? Like a little miniature kangaroo?
Oh, Rue wasn't Winnie the Pooh.
Winnie the Pooh, Rue.
The kangaroo.
That's right.
Yeah.
Speaking of depressing, like Led Zeppelin is depressing, Winnie
Eeyore?
The Pooh is kind of depressing.
Eeyore, you know what?
Colt, did you think Winnie the Pooh was a little depressing?
Yeah, he's a little sad.
Only Eeyore that's sad.
No, Winnie the Pooh was kind of sad, too.
They're all
storms.
Sad.
They're always in storms.
They're in storms. They're always, like, you know, Winnie
they're
the Pooh
they're going through
just,
the emotions.
Like, Winnie the Pooh was the Charlie Brown of animals.
I'll agree.
Disagree with me. Yeah, everybody agrees.
Disagree.
Winnie the Pooh. Mom, did you like Winnie the Pooh?
Nope.
No, she wasn't a fan either.
You know what
my
else is depressing?
My mom showed us stuff like Chitty Chitty Bang Bang, The Muppets, all like funny, fun stuff. Hmm. Not that people shouldn't watch cartoons and get depressed.
No,
we're getting
shouldn't.
Way off topic. How did you shoot this awesome deer?
Well, what I'm doing in my...
Now, look at it. People can't even talk when we talk about a serious subject.
What I'm doing in my professional career led me down this path, and I met some amazing people, and they invited me to this awesome ranch over in Michigan, and they wanted me to experience what they're offering and what their other customers experience, and I got the invite from Legends Ranch to come over and spend a few days with them and got to see more big deer and... experience more hospitality than I've ever experienced in my life. It was an amazing experience. It was amazing.
That's something to be said.
Yeah.
And it's, you know, that's crazy because it's like right around the corner. Michigan's not far. I went up there, and something that I'd actually love to see, I'd love to see Wisconsin allow the hunting of different types of cervids and, you know, ranch style hunting, you know, wild boars, things like that. I mean, you got to be careful with the wild boars because they can escape and become feral pigs. And that's nice that we don't have that problem in Wisconsin. But there's nothing wrong with, you know, some of the sheep, some of the goats that people want to hunt.
Absolutely.
Having them available here in a more controlled ranch-style environment. And so I think that's exciting. And real quickly, you know, you work for a software company that helps these outfitters cater to customers across the board. And I think you're ahead of the curve. And I think we're going to see this spread throughout the country because it really, there is a boutique end of hunting. I call it retail hunting. That's what I call it.
Retail. That makes sense.
I kind of just made that up, but I have friends, they're retail hunters. And that's fine. Not everybody is in the sloughs like, you know, Ian and me driving around every night trying to find geese in a field. Not everybody's like that. And the beauty of Wisconsin is we have the resources and we've got the land and the lakes and the water to offer every type of hunter something.
Yep, every type of hunter. Everything's out there for us right now.
One thing I want to add to that is that the place I was just at Legends Ranch, they're doing amazing things to spread conservation and bring in people that really could use this opportunity and expose them to hunting in a way that they could never be exposed otherwise.
They
got this wildlife center up there. There's thousands of mounts in there, and they sell beautiful artwork, and they use all the money that they raise through this place to bring in educational groups, students. They bus them in on field trips to show them this place, show them conservation, show them hunting. They do this Purple Heart hunt, and they bring in 8 Purple Heart recipients every single year, and they get to go hunt and have this experience and just— it really exposes a lot of people that otherwise wouldn't be exposed to the hunting sport, and gives them such a great, great feeling after.
And this is Legends Ranch?
Legends Ranch.
Is it up in the UP or?
No, it's Central Michigan. Beautiful, beautiful place. Amazing hospitality. Beautiful food. I left there feeling I wanted to do better. I wanted to treat people better. I wanted to spread conservation. I wanted to bring more people into this game. I wanted people to feel what I felt after leaving. And it made me want to continue doing what I'm doing and push forward and spread this so that other people could experience it.
And
all.
I think something that people don't realize is we've got a ton of places like that in Wisconsin already.
Absolutely.
And people don't realize that. I mean, the whitetails of Wisconsin have got hunting ranches for some of the most beautiful whitetail in the country right here in the state of Wisconsin. And those, you know, there are anti-hunters and people who are against it who are trying to close places like that down. And what they don't understand is that places, you know, places like Warren Valley, Milford Hills, hunting ranches for pheasant and upland game, folks like Scott Getzka, who runs his place up north in Wisconsin for whitetails and for pheasants. These are some of the biggest contributors to conservation in the state of Wisconsin, and people don't realize that.
And growing this community, exposing new people to it. You know, if you don't grow up in this world and nobody grabs you by the hand and says, try this, the only opportunity you're ever going to have is to be lucky enough to experience it through one of these businesses,
right,
and get a great experience and take that other places in your life and grow.
Well, that's like you and me. We both started hunting late in life. You started,
right. I started
30,
at age 38.
38, and I started at 24, 25.
Yeah.
Like somebody needed to be like, hey, let me show you this. And I was like hooked
so
from then.
My boss was actually with me. He came, the primary owner of Romeo Bravo Software. He was invited along to go to Legends Ranch. He shot his first animal, and I was with him, and I got to experience it, and it was one of the most emotional things. And I mean,
oh, wow.
I saw the tears come down his face, and you could just feel him being brought
into
a community that, you know, he's serving, but now he can feel it and serve it in such a deeper, better way.
I that is still to this day the most exciting thing to me. And Kretschmer, you had to have a little bit of that kind of feeling the first time we hunted together, because when I was 38 years old, I didn't know my rear end from apple butter.
Right.
I don't know.
Okay.
My dad used to say that, except he used the word ass instead of rear end. But that's not a banned word. No, we're good. We're cool with ass.
he
Anastasia
right
said we can say ass.
The thing with that is, I've been doing it since I've been 12, 13, bow hunting, my first animal. Like, I sat there and cried just because, I mean, the way it went down. But it opened me to this whole experience. And I would say I've shot in a lot of big deer, and I've been on some amazing waterfowl hunts where you do the work and it's like, okay, Joel, your turn. Okay, Ian, your turn. Like, where you don't all have to go guns blazing.
Mm-hmm.
Those are the memorable hunts. But my two probably most are with my kids. I still get emotional, as you can tell, but they get so excited, and I'm literally crying. With Brady, we have it on film on that little bit of an online show that I did for a while. And Ryan, who filmed it, he looked at me after and he goes, I've never seen such raw emotion. And he's filmed with Babe Winkleman and some of these really big name outdoor guys. And he's like, that's the most real thing I've just ever seen. And I was
that's
like,
that's right.
Because that level of the first time with somebody else doing it, or you're putting in all the work to take somebody new and they do it and they're like, what did I just do? And he's like,
do you ever notice that when someone gets their first kill, when you're with them, they don't jump up and down, start screaming. The first thing they do is look at you because they want to confirm
that just happened.
Yeah.
Like, they look at you like whoever you take, there's no better feeling in the world. And you say, you did it. You got it. It all came together. The plan came together. And you know, that's something that I can't, one of the reasons I can't stand criticism of ranch hunting, because for many people, adults want a controlled environment for their child. Someone wants a controlled environment for their, someone who's new to hunting. There was somebody with a disability. They want a, you know, a controlled environment. Yeah. You still have every aspect of that hunt. And maybe you hunt on a ranch style the first 10 times. Maybe you hunt, you know, off a ranch and you search for those geese and ducks and you hunt that way. And then later in life you start ranch style hunting because you don't have the physical ability to do the wild all wild hunts. There is such a place for it in our spectrum of conservation.
There's something really real about hunting, right? It's just like we were born this way. This is how we live for so many years, so many millennia. And to be able to experience that for people that don't have the capability to buy all the gear and go out and make it happen to themselves, it's something very, very special and something that it's just amazing to share with other people.
Yeah, there's no doubt about it.
The point is, like, I know we're getting close here, but
20 seconds, get it to me.
It doesn't have to cost $20,000. You can go to a ranch and go shoot a doe. You can go
shoot a goat.
Yes.
Also, you know, that's donated. They do that, you know, as
family. Especially if you're a kid. Welcome back to Raised in Whisker. I'm your host, Joel Clayfish, sitting alongside Danielle Fairman. You're listening to our show on 540 AM WAUK 101 FM, The Shaw. Born and raised here, folks. That's probably why it's called Raised in Wisco, I would imagine.
Weird. What a quinkadink.
I had somebody ask me the other day, like, hey, I'm listening to your show. Where did you grow up? I'm like, I was raised in Wisco.
South Texas. Yeah,
South Texas. Hey, I'm going to start bringing out accents on this show. I love doing accents.
Oh, no. I hate.
No. Anastasia's like, no, don't
no,
do
no,
accents.
No, 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 no.
You can't. There's some accents you can't do anymore.
There are no accents you can do, though. That's the difference. Well, and I don't mean skill.
Ooh.
I mean permission.
Wait, hold on.
I mean permission.
I can't do a Southern accent even?
That's one of the seven.
What, East Coast? Was that the last one you said?
No, yeah, like East Coast, Southern. Oh. I can't do a Southern British accent. I couldn't get away with that.
Just be careful, Joel.
There's too much political correctness. Now
that's
we can't
not
even
what
be
it
fun.
Is.
It, what is it? I don't know what it is. I don't even get. You know, we went into the break talking about the magic of taking people hunting, and whether that's on a ranch style hunt, whether that's in the wild. You know, I don't think it matters, but the lesson and the progression of hunting is something that we talk about quite a bit, but I also think it's something that actually really matters.
You know what also is kind of funny about that is you're talking about the different styles of hunting, correct?
Yes.
So I started with literally garbage bags for goose decoys in the field before I'd go to
garbage
school.
Garbage bags?
Like, what? Black garbage bags in the field.
It worked.
It worked. It worked. I'm telling
you. Ian, do you think we should try that?
No, you can't bring
We're
it
out there
school.
With our fully flocked,
yes,
full body.
Yes, that's the problem now. So it's
you know, they weigh like 700 pounds
it's
each.
It's evolved so much that you can't get away with that anymore,
well,
right?
But you kind of can do it with Snuggie.
Ian actually brings the paddles along because I'm hauling those decoys out and I'm like, and by the time we get out
it might work opening day.
Yeah.
5 minutes in.
Maybe you get one crack at them, but that's about it.
Early season.
But
what were you going to say about that?
One thing, though, is I think it's just absolutely amazing, the sport of waterfowling and how much it's evolved. Because I remember when I was a kid, when I started, I was going out at 9, not hunting, just spectating. And then I started hunting when I was 10.
And you just turned 16, right?
Yeah.
He actually
For the
has
record, I'm 22 years old.
He's officially a teenager.
Years young, maybe.
Here's the thing. Here's the crazy thing. When Ian talks about when he first started hunting, it's still way after I started hunting. I lose that fact sometimes because I started when I was 38. And I understand, guys, I only look like a mid-30s young man. But yeah. I'm actually 52, so I've technically been hunting several years before Ian started. But he's 22 now, and he's been hunting since he was 9. What are you thinking about Kretschmer? You got a look of you're perplexed.
An hour is not long enough.
Well, move the mic over yourself and make your point.
No, I'm just going to say, I wanted to bring back the lodge hunting, the poor man's hunting, the guy that can go spend $2,000 on goose decoys. You got to remember, there's guided hunts as well, right? So you can pay somebody to do the outdoor wild side of it versus a ranch, but those still cost money. So at what point is the lodge mentality has got to get out of the hunting industry? It's like he shot a 170-inch deer in a lodge or in a resort. That, great for him, right?
100%.
But now that's people look at that as a bad thing in a certain way because it's considered high fence. But what's the difference between that and a guy going with a guide that is out in the woods in the public?
Finding the animals and putting you on them.
And putting you on for the same amount of money, 15, 18 grand, and you're roughing it.
There is no difference.
Correct. That's my point.
But and I'm
the difference is accessibility and how people that normally couldn't get to those places way out in the wild. And
Yes, no question.
And the difference is that these places that are, these businesses, these ranches, these established places and what they can do to provide contributions to the hunting industry, whether that's hunters education programs, exposing new hunters,
no doubt,
and raise fundraising issues, and it contributes a lot.
The bottom line is everything has its place.
Everything.
And so what irritates me beyond belief, it just irritates the heck out of me, is why we try to stop any of it. Anybody out there, look, thank goodness we're past the whole vegan phase.
It was a phase
because now everybody knows protein is one of the healthiest things you can put in your body. So if you're out there and you can look me in the eye and tell me you don't eat a hamburger, fine. Maybe you don't. But if you eat a hamburger, you should strongly support any type of hunting, from a ranch down to backyard squirrel hunting. You should support each and every second of it, because if you're getting your protein source and taking it from the field or the woods to the table, you are assuming much more responsibility than the person who goes and buys a package of meat. There is nothing wrong with buying a package of meat. Mm-mm. And God love our farmers for supplying it, because without them, we wouldn't exist. No doubt about it.
The other thing I want to add about the ranch hunting too is that you have this magical ability in the way that they present this experience to you, and tons of it is donated, and tons of it they do for just free.
Oh, for sure.
These doe hunts, and they use it for their doe management. But to take these people that may be struggling, and even it's such a healthy drug, even if it's depression or anything, they bring these people in,
do for veterans.
Yeah, and veterans, mm-hmm. They bring you in, they treat you like gold, you leave feeling like $1 million, and it's better than any drug you could ever take.
In Africa, for example, they use the meat to feed the local communities, and a lot of the money is raised to put in water systems, you know, to bring clean water to people.
I cannot wait to go to Africa. With the whole group. I'm so pumped for this.
It's the greatest thing on earth.
But back to the whole, like, spending money on a resort or anything like that, I go out with no decoys, with my dog and my kayak.
And like, you
just go pass shooting and all that kind of stuff. Like, they have all these wetlands for us to go publicly.
And
open
guess
to everybody.
Who supports and is the reason for all of it? The hunters, the Pittman Robertson funds, the money that we spend buying bullets allows the sideways banana, boaters to be out there, and the people to climb the mountains, and the people to camp at Wisconsin campsites. Everything that outdoors folks do is the reason the state of Wisconsin has the conservation, has the facilities, has the outdoors we have. If it were not for people who work their tail off to enjoy the outdoors, hunting, fishing, kayaking, biking, hiking,
camping,
rock climbing, camping,
all the things,
we would not have the resources we have. And that's why I guess I get so frustrated with people who are critical of any of those aspects. Because if you're critical of any of those aspects, I think that's a holier-than-thou attitude that should not exist in the state of Wisconsin. Because unless you are literally a person who doesn't eat a hamburger, then you don't have a right to say that. And that's how fast the show went. That was an awesome show. I laughed my butt off.
Yep.
We got good material. We talked about taking new hunters out, the great resources in Wisconsin, top to bottom. And best of all, I've got old friends in the studio with me. I've hunted with Danielle for more than a decade. Colt and I have known each other forever. Kretschmer, one of the first people I took out.
Woo.
Ian Kittrell, one
Paige,
of my tightest guys
Mom,
in the hunting industry. His girlfriend, Paige, which I think it's going well. We'll see you next week.